Hey, all right. My name is Paige Meyer. I'm the Director of Early Learning for the Kent School District. And this is Alice Humphreys, and she's the Coordinator of Early Learning for the Kent School District. And I just want to say a few words before I turn it over to Alice to take you through a quick icebreaker. First of all, I'm just so thankful that it's not raining. Because I know people tend to, I know I'm the same, say, maybe not tonight. It's too rainy, yucky, I just want to stay at home. So I'm so thankful that it's not raining. And I'm secondly just have such tremendous gratitude for all of you coming out this evening in response to pretty much a cold call email. Although some of you do know us, and we've visited some of you, and some of you we work with pretty regularly. So just can't even tell you how much we appreciate your being here. It shows that there is a great desire for collaboration between the early learning community and the Kent School District, and so we're really excited to be sharing this kickoff event with you. And I want to let you know that we will be having another event in March on the 3rd, and that will be, I will follow up and send you an email and invite you back, and I have great news about that one. It's going to be in the boardroom. So I want to compliment each and every one of you for finding your way back to the educational support building in the dark. I hope some of you saw the balloons. This is the date that worked for us, and we really wanted to get this going and not put it off anymore, and the boardroom wasn't available tonight. So, but it is available in March. Tonight we're going to focus on literacy. And in March, we're going to focus on math. And as you'll see in your exit ticket that we do with you today, we are looking for your feedback about what you want out of these kinds of get-togethers, as well as what is your expertise that you can bring to this group, to this space. So it's not just Kent School District here telling you how things are. We know that everybody in the room has something to share, and so we just want to create a space and a relationship for that to happen. So, let's see, a couple other things before I continue. I want to introduce some very important people. So, first of all, we have Stephanie Jaden, and she is our pre-K through 8th, no, pre-K through 12?
Six.
Okay, it's Let's take it from literacy specialist, and she is our guest speaker tonight, and she's going to be talking to you about our kindergarten, first, second grade literacy curriculum and giving you some takeaway ideas to take back to your programs. And then I would like to introduce our absolute VIPs. We have two of our school board members here, and they're going to come up and say a couple words to you. Just a thank you. This is Ogden Burchard, and then Karen DeBruler. So, and they have joined us here tonight because they really, the whole board values early learning, and they were able to be here to represent our school board, and we very much appreciate their time. So, and Audra would like to say something.
I just really wanted to thank you so much for coming, and like Paige said, in Kent School District K through 12, we have a lot to learn from you. You know the kids really well. You work together with the families really well, and we can do better on that. You do really well with the social emotional development and helping kids get ready for entering kindergarten. So we really value you coming so we can learn from you. And then we also hope that you find this really valuable and things that you can go back and use with your children and families too. So thanks.
Thank you. Karen, you don't have to say anything except hello.
Hello.
Long day.
Yes,
okay.
Long day.
You should have in your hands an agenda, and it's okay to share if you don't have one. And then you should also have a bright orange sheet, which is going to be the icebreaker activity that Alice is going to introduce to you in a moment. And then Stephanie had a few handouts up here. There's the Erla Pre-K level texts. There's sight word acquisition. And then there's another lime green. So if you're missing any of those, please raise your hand and we'll get it to you. Okay. Okay, the last thing I want to say to you before I turn it over to Alice is that on the 19th of January, the Kent School District and all of the Roadmap School Districts, which are the 7 school districts that surround us, Federal Way, Renton, Tukwila, Seattle, Auburn, and who am I leaving out? No, they're not part of the roadmap.
Yeah.
So we are all kicking off a kindergarten registration campaign. I'm gonna wait. Goodbye.
Thank you.
It's
sorry.
Not a problem. I can't compete with the volume.
Okay. My phone has never run in any public situation.
No one ever calls.
That is so funny. So we are kicking off a region-wide kindergarten registration campaign, and what that means is it's like opening day of voting season. It's basically saying, hey, community, get in and register your kids for kindergarten. Do it now. Don't do it in August. Do it now so that you can start getting connected to our schools. So you are going to start seeing posters around the community, banners at all of our schools. They are really cool. I just ordered them and sent them out to the schools today. Ordered them a week ago, sent them out to schools today. There will also be a social media blitz, so to the Kent app, Facebook, Twitter, all that kind of good stuff. So you're gonna see that, and I'm gonna put up a copy of the poster up here so you can see what it looks like, so you can see recognition. And I will also be happy to forward the artwork to you so you can print that out and hang it up in your sites so your parents can see them, or even print copies for you. You just have to let me know. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Alice to do a little icebreaker with you.
Great. Fantastic. Welcome again. You've been warmly welcomed by everybody, and I'm just so pleased that you're all here. We have been working on planning this event so that we could, one, reach out and get to know some of you that we don't know yet, and hope that you would get to know us as well, and begin to build a partnership where we can really support all kids in Kent and all families. So some of you have sat at tables this evening with people you know, but part of this partnership and part of this event is to be able to get to know other people as well, so we make those connections even stronger in our community. So before we begin meeting some other new people, we're going to take just a moment, and on the orange sheet that we talked about, this is a note sheet for you, but as well it's an opportunity for you to do some thinking about your programs that you support each and every day, and the children. And the focus tonight is around literacy. So on this far right hand column here, right hand if I'm here, yeah, left hand if I'm looking at it, this one. On this side are some different aspects of literacy that you may or may not have in your program. I just want you to think for a minute about your own program, your programs you might oversee or the programs that you work in, and think about these aspects of literacy and what are some strategies, what are some tools, what are some things that you might do or the teachers that you know might do in this area. So take just a moment for yourself, my school or classroom, and just think quietly. Do some notes for yourself around these. If these components aren't there, or you don't know what words we might have used, it's okay. Just, I don't know what that is. And just keep going. So we'll give ourselves a couple minutes on that. It looks like many people have written down something on their paper. Now here's the fun part. You'll see the next two columns say get one and name, and get one and name. So here is your challenge over the next couple minutes to walk around and meet somebody new that you haven't met yet in the room, and have a conversation first of, you know, who are you and where do you come from in Kent? What school or organization do you support? And then talk about the strategy that you might want to share, and they're going to talk about one. And you can just make a little note about a new strategy or new idea around literacy, reading, writing, that you might take back to your building or to your school for your students. So I'll have you do the rotating, but we'll probably spend about 5 minutes meeting some new people. So there's your challenge, to walk about as carefully as you can with all the chairs and meet 2 new people. Thank you. We needed a signal, like a little chime. Ding. So thank you. I think that I saw many of you connecting with maybe some folks that you haven't seen in a while that are in the early learning community that support kids and families as well. And I also saw people taking that challenge and meeting new people and sharing ideas. And that really is part of the hope of tonight. So I'm really pleased that you have made some connections outside of the table that you're sitting in. As we move through, feel free to take some more notes on this orange sheet as well as we move into Stephanie's presentation around the district. Focus right now on some of the literacy pieces that are new and that are working within our schools. I wanted to make one more introduction. We had a little oversight and we missed introducing somebody who's really important to our schools as well. Allison Dino is here tonight. And Allison is a school improvement officer, and she supports some of our elementary schools, in particular ones that have the dual language program that are supporting that. So welcome. We're glad you're here.
Can I say one more thing?
Yes.
We have a couple preschool and kindergarten teachers that are Kent employees that are here to meet and mix with you. Can you raise your hands? If you're, yeah. So they're here too because they want to meet
yeah,
you.
We all bond together.
Really. Yeah. We got one up here. Wanted you to see that.
And with that, that's a great segue. Thank you very much. We wanted to do one more thing. You've had the chance to mix and mingle a little bit. We want to just do a little show of, you don't have to necessarily move or do anything other than maybe raise your hand or stand up, but we wanted to have a show of what, who we have in our audience joining us tonight. So if you are a early provider, birth to three, and you're in the room, would you please just give us a little wave so we can see. Fantastic. Okay. Perfect. If you provide services birth to five in a pre-K program, whether it's Head Start, a private program, perfect. That should be a lot of us, yeah.
How about, if, are you an ECAP or Head Start?
We're Head Start.
Yes. Okay, good. How about an in-home provider? And a private parochial. Program. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Private non-parochial. Okay. Great. We have a lot of representation from all the different sectors of our early learning community.
Awesome. Thank you for being here. So with that, I'm going to introduce Stephanie Jaden, who you met a little earlier, but Stephanie, take it away.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
And Paige is going to pull up my PowerPoint.
Yeah, that's the poster. That's the kindergarten registration poster. Super cute. So now you know what it looks like when you see it popping up all over the place. All right. And then I'm going to put Stephanie's. Pardon?
When does registration start?
The 19th. So it, forever it will be the Tuesday after Martin Luther King Day. Whatever day that is. And this year it's the 19th.
So I'm Stephanie Jaden, and as they said, I'm the pre-K-6 literacy specialist. And so I spend a lot of my time with kindergartners, but I'm going to back up a little and tell you a little about me personally. Is my daughter was in a co-op preschool with me back in 1992 for four-year-olds, and it was just such a great experience. I had nothing to do with teaching before then. And the teacher was like, you'd be a great teacher. And I just was like, wow, that's the nicest thing ever, right? And then the whole year, we just had so much fun. And I actually was a kindergarten mom at Panther Lake. And the kindergarten teacher there, some of you will remember Kathy Cook from way back. She said, get your own classroom. And so I actually went back to school that spring and became a teacher, went back to college. And so it's because of a preschool teacher and a kinder teacher that I am here, which is a great thing. So I have worked all different grade levels in Kent, K-6 except fifth grade. I did fifth grade summer school at Neely. But I started at Neely O'Brien in 1997, and I just absolutely loved it, fell in love with it. And then I ended up going to Lake Young's with HICAP program, the Highly Capable program, and then ended up back at Neely as the literacy specialist. And then Emerald Park, sixth grade. I've been all over the place. And then I came here last year. I was teaching sixth grade and then spent all of last year in kindergarten, where I met these ladies. down at Kent Valley a lot and other kindergarten rooms working with Erla. And it is amazing. So I'm going to talk to you about Erla tonight. And Erla is our independent reading level assessment framework that we use in the district. And I actually have some things on your table that we're going to be digging through a little tonight. And I'm going to show you the cover of the Erla. Each table does have one Erla, if you do want to look at that. And this is a pre-K-12 book. This is huge, but it is all the way through 12th grade. So I'm going to be talking about this tonight, and I gave you some handouts that you can refer to. So I'm going to start with this slide about our focus. And we show this in all of the classes that I teach too for literacy. Like right now I'm teaching a 5th, 6th grade class at night for one of our new initiatives. But our goal is all students leave their grade level reading on or above grade level. And then what we're teaching the Common Core State Standards. And then these are the resources that are new to Kent. So pre-K-2 we have Journeys, and some of you have heard of Splash, which is the pre-K Journeys. Grade 6, we have Expeditionary Learning, which a lot of people used to call Engage New York, and that's, we call it EL. And then K-3, we have Erla, and that's this giant book. This is our framework. And then some schools, like one of my schools, Park Orchard, they do it K-6 with their kids. And so I'm going to be walking you through the pre-K into a little bit of first grade tonight, just to get your feet wet with it. But I'm one of those people that if I'm in an audience and I have a question, I kind of want to ask it if it pertains to that. Feel free to ask me a question. Just, you know, put your hand up and that's fine. So here's our literacy block that's 100 minutes for K-2 in the district right now. And so I'm gonna turn off the front light. Some of you are having a hard time seeing.
Oops, that's the back light. Is that a little better?
It is.
Okay, yeah. Great. So we have 15 minutes for foundational skills, 20 minutes for skills and strategies, the lesson, a mini lesson, setting purpose. Then we have 30 minutes of sacred Erla time during the day. And that 30 minutes is where the teacher could have small groups, be conferring with students. Students are working on stamina reading, the independent reading, and that is the Erla block that I spend a lot of my time in. And then there's writing instruction that's 30 minutes. And so I'm going to be speaking to this block today, the 30 minutes of Erla time. So with Erla, like I said, we have pre-K all the way here, which is purple, and we call it Read to Me, RTM, Read to Me. Mm-hmm. All the way up through 12th grade, which is gold. And so we use it for all students K-2 and some of our struggling third graders have Erla, and then some schools 6th grade. I am just pulling out this part tonight. The pre-K, the Read to Me, the kindergarten, which is 1Y, yellow, 2Y, 3Y, we call it Y for yellow, and then 1 green, 1G. And so I have this for you to just give you, get your feet wet, and then I'm going to go into depth with that. So it's also on the cover of the Erla, if you have one of those in front of you. This you have a handout of. I'm going to let you pull that out on top, and I gave you a handout of that so you can take notes on it, but I broke it down a little more so each part has a whole slide, but yours has all three on one page. Great. So I'm just going to be talking about Read to Me for right now, and Read to Me is a pre-K level. In Kent, we have a lot of kindergartners come in that are Read to Me. And Read to Me might mean many things in kindergarten. It might mean that that student is a newcomer.
and they haven't had any access to books. It could be that they weren't read too much in their younger days. It could be maybe they didn't have preschool. There are many reasons for Read to Me, and so we have to address all of those in the classroom.
We actually have a lot of Read to Me's in sixth grade that come in as newcomers. And so that's a challenge that we deal with too. So it's not just in kindergarten.
And so at the very beginning of kindergarten, they come in as a Read to Me. And that's when, in a month, we try to inundate that child with about 500 books. And that could be a small book being read to them. That could be them hearing poetry. That could be having a buddy that reads with them that's a kindergartner or a sixth grader. There are many ways to do that. It could be a Read to Me in the classroom. It could be with a small group. It could be one-on-one. So in a lot of our schools, we have custodians that take on Read to Me buddies. We have a lunch lady at Emerald Park that does that. We have a lot of Read to Me tubs in the hallways at schools where that happens. And so it's a village mentality. Our Read to Me students, we're going to read to those little kiddos. At Park Orchard, they line the hallways in the morning. They don't have morning recess. And the sixth graders and fifth graders, they have little buddies. They have the tubs lining the hallway. And every morning you walk right down the hallway and there are hundreds of kids being read to. And it's an amazing thing. And so those are Read to Me kiddos. And we want them to learn reading behaviors and fall in love with reading. So we want it fun. We want it where they can be singing songs. And a lot of you are nodding with me. And this is exactly what I think of with preschool too, the things that you're doing with the kids. We want them hearing pattern books. Those are what we call yellow books, which I'll get into shortly. We want them hearing storybooks, fairy tales, poetry, predictive text. I always think Miss Bendergarten gets ready for kindergarten, and it has that sing song. Oh, I love that book. And I used to give that to every kindergartner coming into Neely O'Brien every year. And it was just one of those books where it's a feel-good book, and there's more than one story, so it's fantastic. We went rhythmic, we went clapping, singing, wordplay, letter sounds, all of those things. I see most of you nodding along, that's great. So, with Read to Me, you can think, wow, 500 books in a month? That's a lot. But some of the books are like this. Or it's within class time. Okay. I'm going to show you some pattern books, which are now the yellow books I just referred to. And the pattern books have quite a range. We start with one Y, or yellow, and this is on your sheet too, and that's where this child can hold a simple sentence pattern. I see the, I see the, I see the. Then they're using the picture clue to figure out, I see the zebra, I see the dog. It's a very simple picture for them. Then, if they can do this, we start the child on tracking each word. And that can be really difficult for some students. And so this is when, even when you're using counters and one-to-one correspondence in math, that helps with their tracking and reading. It's pretty amazing. That was new to me when I took over, when I got into Erla, went into this position. After being in sixth grade, I didn't think about those things for a long time, but that math can help with the tracking also. I'm gonna show you some things I've learned this past year with helping kids track. Then we go into 3Y, and that's when the student gets their mouth ready to make the initial consonant sound. I see the picture's a dog. The word starts with duh, and you see them go duh. Dog. Or if they say puppy and they're ready for this stage, I say, does that start with puppy? And they'll say, oh, the dog. And that's when you know they can differentiate. They're getting ready to make that initial consonant sound. And that's an exciting time. It's very exciting because it's a whole new world opening up.
I'm in those little kinder chairs. It's so hard. Hats off. So I come back to the office. Oh my gosh. I feel so just out of whack from it. But I like to be level with the student, as level as I can be, that eye to eye, because I'm often like, look at my mouth. And I make the sound and I have them make the sound. And we do that face to face a lot. And a lot of you are nodding. I love it. So here, on the inside of the books from American Reading Company, which is the owner of Erla, you often have this where it tells you what yellow readers do. And I love this because if these books go home, and we bought them so they'd go home and be in the classroom, it tells them, if you're a one wide, remember and use the sentence pattern to read the rest of the book. Then it says figure out the one word that changes. That's the dog or the cat or the horse in that. Two wide, they're tracking, and that's when we're also teaching that we don't track by swiping across. We actually pick up our finger. There's a space between words. And that was a big aha to me as well last year. I thought, how many children have I ruined by swiping? Right? Are you doing that in your head? Oh no, all those poor children. It's a miracle my daughter can read after I swiped, right? So three wide, put your mouth in position. So get your mouth ready for the sound, is what I always tell kids. And they get so used to that. And then say a word that matches that initial consonant. Now, I'm gonna be showing you a video in a little bit. And it's going to walk through a little boy doing that. He's in this phase, 2Y, getting ready for 3Y. So here is my favorite book, Little House. I love this book. And this is as simple as the patterns get in these books. There's little bed, little rug, and it's this ladybug that lives in this tiny house, and it's just adorable. And so I've taken this book and I've made it a dot book. And a dot book is where I use the quarter inch Avery dots, the permanent ones. These have saved my life. Is I actually put a dot here and I put a dot where I want the child pointing to track that word. And so they can feel this. So I tried highlighters, I tried markers. It has to be the dot. They have to feel it. Little bed. Because you've seen those kids, they see kids pointing, but they don't know where. Yeah. So they're literally like this with their finger. You have to feel the dot, little bed. And it is amazing what that does as a scaffold for that child. And so I do that through the book. And I have schools where we've done a lot of dot books on the yellow books. And so when they rotate room to room, the teachers know, lucky me, dot books. And so the teams, we sit down and do it, or have older students do it for us that are really fussy and will do it just right. And it's fantastic because the students know when they're choosing their books, you're in dot books right now. And we just call them dot books. So here.
Question.
Yes, perfect, thank you.
Is there a place that you go that always has those in stock? Where do you get those dots?
Where do you get your dots? Oh, the dots are just office supply stores.
Oh, okay.
And you might have, if you're in a school, you might have thousands of these in a drawer and not even know it. Mm-hmm. Some of them are in sheets where they have multicolor on them. Mm-hmm. And so I actually went through one of our drawers last year here and found them. And they're the quarter inch Avery permanent. Don't be fooled by the cute colored ones. They will fall off. So last year I was walking out of a room and I looked down and I have dots all over me and they're just falling off the book. So they're not worth it. I like
the picture and
thank
send
you.
It out to everybody.
Fabulous. Okay. This is one of the books that might be on your table, and this is called Red All Around. And this is a pattern book, more than two words on a page. This flower is red. Everything in this book is about red. They have this book green all around, yellow all around, purple all around, blue all around. So this gets a little harder because the word changes here, not at the end. And so the student has to then look at the picture before the end of that pattern.
And so it's the it just upped the difficulty there. This pattern book, another one of my favorites. I don't go anywhere without this. Look at Me. That's the name of the book. It sounded bossy, I know. It's a dot book. And I'm showing you this page specifically because a lot of our kids with limited English really get stuck on feathers. They say leaves. And then here they say arm. Mm-hmm. So we have to say specifically with a bird, and so I really, this is when I would be with a child one-on-one with this, and this tells me too, I can really tell from this book if they have limited English, just from a bird. A bird is very common to see if they know about them. I also take a highlighter, and I highlight the F and the W, so I can see if that child might have that initial consonant. And so it's just a reminder to me when I do that, look at my, and if they say leaves, I can say, does that start with the sound for leaves? And I can see if they even know that sound or if they can figure it out. If they don't, I don't worry about it. They're not there yet. So I'm just working on the tracking and the picture clues. And just hold that pattern. Look at my, look at my. But again, one of my favorite dot books. So this is what I use initially with a child, and then I build and build. Now here's my trick with dot books, is I have this range of pattern books, and there are the patterns that go double pattern, opposing pages, that you work up to. And I take those, and when I think a student's ready to graduate to non-dot books, and they have the tracking down, I've only dotted half of that book. And when they get to that halfway point, they look at the page, they always say, you forgot to dot this page. I said, oh, we'll keep going. And they do, or they don't. And that's when I know if they still need the scaffold or if they're ready to graduate out of dot books. And it's amazing. And they always do that, though. You forgot. Oh, silly me. It's just picking those things up because of spending last year almost exclusively in kindergarten and just watching and seeing all these things and picking up tricks that this is amazing how easy it is to do and how helpful. I saw a hand somewhere.
Oh,
go ahead.
Yeah, that's a lot of work for the teachers. It might be a good idea just to ask the kids to put the dots on the words. It's also a very good knowing for them to figure out which one is the vowels or which one the consonants. They can put the dots on the main vowels.
Right, and the dot book is only for those who are struggling with tracking the words. So it's not mm-hmm. students who might even know what mm-hmm. vowels or consonants are yet. Mm-hmm. So this is way, way back before that. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I would ask fifth or sixth graders, I'm in a school usually, to help me.
Help you.
Yes. I would, yes, a kindergartner, I have a hard time getting this dot off. It's permanent. So usually I have to be scraping on it.
Just right,
right
with the marker.
And that's when I tried that last year, but they couldn't feel it.
Oh, yeah.
And it's
I
that touching it really did
yeah.
help. And so I kind of, because I thought, oh, I can use a highlighter.
Yeah,
and it just didn't do the same thing as that touching it and mm-hmm. Did.
Mm-hmm. I did like the pop stickers, like so covered it up, so one word to another word, another word.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe it doesn't. There's no texture on it, so.
Right, and some kids mm-hmm. could do that, but this is for the students who are struggling
mm-hmm.
with tracking. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't do dot books with every student. It's just the ones that it's holding them back, and I know they can do more in other areas. And I want to see if the dot book will help them with that.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Okay. Here's another pattern book that I even do lessons with. I see zebras at the zoo. So again, they have to look at the picture midway through the pattern, which is harder. But I love this book because it has lions and tigers. And so the kid, and it has cheetahs and leopards. So you can see where I'm going with that. I can see if they're ready for that initial consonant. Because just yesterday at Daniel, I was teaching it, and the students, except one, said, leopard. And this other says, cheetah. And I said, how do you know? Why do you think? Everybody else says that. Well, look at the letter. It says, and it doesn't say, oh. And I was like, oh my gosh. And then we talked about it. I said, even if you don't know, like there's one of penguins. If you don't know this word says penguins, we're going to look at the picture. If we still don't know the picture, we can see if we're ready for that initial consonant for a clue. So it's pretty nice. So I have certain books I use, after using them dozens of times, that really help me out when I'm seeing if they're ready for the next stage in that yellow, the one yellow to two yellow to three yellow that's on that note sheet I gave you. After these books, I often ask questions of the students or the whole class. Some of these I do with the whole class. And I ask Common Core questions. So what was this book mostly about? And then I work on stems with the students. You know, the picture shows, or the text said, we say the word said, or the book said, and then we work up to that later with the text told me that, or my friend Allison told me that she learned. And so we often do that where it's accountable talk, and I want you not thinking about what you're going to say, but what did I learn that you can tell the class. So they're not checked out thinking, what I did. And so it's about listening to the whole class too. So we work into that in kindergarten. We're at that midway point of the year where we're really pushing that now with accountable talk. And it's amazing. By the end of the year, they're doing exit slips. It's just quite amazing the progression they take through IRLA. So when I have a class as a whole that's at the beginning of the year, very beginning, I have these anchor charts I use. They're on the chart paper that I take into classes. This one's how we read, and I used at the zoo. So I actually had a picture. We use pictures to help us read, which is a kindergarten foundational skill here. And it has, I see penguins at the zoo, like I told you about, and then I highlighted around penguins, and that's what I teach the class. If I don't know this word, I use the picture. We're reading the picture with every page we turn. We track each word with a finger. It's a foundational skill for kinder. I see monkeys at the zoo, and I pick a two-syllable word to see if they fly past that. I see monkeys at the, oh no, I've run out of dots. So then I can explain, only a word gets a dot. That's a word, then there's a space. And it's just, that's the dot helping me again. And I even have this little kid hand with the dot to show them. And we have this near the group area where students invariably walk over and put their hand right there. So this is their goal, their power goal. My goal is to point under each word as I say it. My goal is to read the picture. And these are all in the yellow, the handout I gave you that's talking about one yellow, two yellow, three yellow. These are all the things they need to know for IRLA. I just took them out and put them on anchor charts that we can build on. And so even if I have a newcomer in sixth grade, say, I can still talk about the pictures and work through things like that with them. Oh my gosh, I'm right on time. That's okay, my timing. Small miracle there. Okay, so I'm going to give you a moment to just chat amongst yourselves at your table while I set up the, I make sure my speakers are on, while I set up the video. And just go ahead and talk so far about read to me and the progression through the 1Y, 2Y, 3Y. So go ahead and take a few minutes of talk time, please.
I feel like I'm talking.
Thank you. Help me out. Now, when I used to do that with primary classes, I would do my sixth grade in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and they'd just look at me. But when I started doing that, it helped me out a lot. But I can't clap with the older.
So the things we have it working, the sound's going to come from here, and I'm going to go ahead and start it. This is about a little boy named Ridley. And Ridley is going to be going through a book, and he's in that between 2Y, just getting into 3Y. He's not solid into 3Y yet. He's still into the 2Y, and you can see that on his face. He's not quite sure about all this. So I'm hoping we'll be able to hear from this. We don't have any bigger speakers in here, so I apologize if it's not too loud. So I have him in a 2Y little group, and then I push him into a 3Y once in a while to kind of front load, this is what's coming, buddy. And when I want you reading that picture, how he said running instead of rabbit, they're both R. We don't expect him to read that. So that's totally doable. Because of the initial consonant, she kept checking that with him, if he was right or wrong. So it was both ways, not just checking, not just asking if you're wrong to double check it, but did that start with W, woof, woof, for water? Yes, it did. He got a lot of them without help.
Grass, rock, things like that.
Werewolf. Yeah. Werewolf. That was perfect.
So I have a question. So
yes.
This works for the children whose home language is English. How about other children that they have speak Spanish or Chinese at
right.
home?
We actually have a lot of kids that English is the language maybe at school. That's quite common. And so I've seen great growth in kids who might be in the ELL program in limited English because they're getting read to all the time and worked with all the time. And so we actually have very good growth with those students. Mm-hmm. It has been a great surprise that they're doing so well with it. Mm-hmm. In most the schools I work with, are exclusively students where there are maybe struggling learners, a lot of students who are in the ELL program, and those are the schools I work with. That's a great question. So he was adorable, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He's so cute. And so now, you had a little chat time earlier, but now I'd like you to talk about what you're already doing that you've seen tonight. Or something that you could build on, something you're doing and saying, oh, now I know I could build on something doing this. And then I would like for each table group to, we have so many in the room, to just have one share out. So I'll give you a couple minutes to share, and then maybe have one idea that you all like, that you'd like to share out, because you are the brain trust here. You are the experts in the room. And so we would like, maybe if you have something, for them to hear it. If they have something, you can hear it like that. So please take a couple of minutes and share amongst yourselves and then have one share out for us. Who just has to go first? Who is really wanting to share out first? Everybody, oh, we need to share.
Oh my gosh.
Okay, so I'm going to bring you back together so we can hear we're over here.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Because I'm from old school, I will use more pictures. I wasn't aware that there was that much literacy in the pictures. So I've always been the phonics, sounded out, follow that word. So the running and rabbit really caught me, but I understand, so I think that's really important to use those pictures more. So
that is fabulous. Thank you. Then over here?
Yeah.
Would you mind turning this way a bit to project your voice? Thank you.
Sure. Yeah. What I use in my, we do a lot of reading, like circle time and reading. And then I use a lot of books, like easy books, for example, like Brown Bear, or Chica Chica Boom Boom. So the kids, we read those like often, and the kids, it's their favorite books. So as soon as they open the page, they see the picture, so brown bear, what do you see? And then yellow bird, so they see. They say, I see a yellow bird, and then they read each page. And then I have like small books like that where they are their favorite books. And also when we do activities like when we, for example, we learn about colors. So I make like small books for them. And then, like, for example, if we're learning the red, the color red, so it says, the first picture, it says, the balloon is red, and then the heart is red. So they're learning the word the and is, and then they just have to see the picture, and then they read the...
You've written pattern books.
Yeah.
You've done the same thing. That's fabulous. Yeah, thank you.
So every time we're learning something, I make small books. So we are learning about the subject, and at the same time, I put the literacy.
Thank you. And that's fantastic because they learn to read that word. They learn that word. At first, we're just having them hold that pattern. They didn't know I could read it to them. I can read the next page. They're holding the pattern using the picture. But then they do start to read it after a while. So at first, hold the pattern, and then we work into the sight words. Fabulous. Anybody else?
I just want to continue with her since she says she has read with the children a lot during the day. Mm-hmm. So I do with my children, which is today we read this book, and I point it every time, read each word. So they actually, after I'm doing other activity, they will try to, you know, do the same thing and copy me while I'm doing pretend she's the teacher. And just like, I think modeling is very important.
It is. Yeah. It is. And the kids love doing that, and it's a good impact for them. Any other table groups? Thank you for sharing. Thank you.
We are teachers in the school district, and this lady here is a home provider. So she was sharing with us what she's doing with her students. And she is doing the same thing that we're doing in the classroom with tracking and working on letter sounds and reading and writing. And she's also collaborated with kindergarten teachers. We've told her, please have these kids ready to do this, which is a really good advocate for working together, the school districts and providers that really help build the academics for our kids coming into kindergarten.
Thank you. That was the group I jumped into to listen, and you were so happy when she was talking.
Can we clone people? Right? Yes. Lots of apps in here started. We can
it's good networking right here. It's fantastic. Let's see.
We can say.
Thank you.
We were thinking, because we blow up some of our rhymes, like Humpty Dumpty and Mary Had a Little Lamb, as part of our curriculum. And since it's already there, we could put the dots up so a child can come up and help read it out loud and trace along in front of the other children, just for the exposure factor of the dots and how to use them, and to start doing the one-to-one correspondence with their power.
That would be fantastic. Thank you. So just taking what you already have and just dotting
it bigger, like a little.
Good. One more table. Okay, thanks. Yes.
So in our class, I'm still preparing my kids to understand, you know, this letter, it comes with a sound, so we're doing letter of the week. And I, each week I would have, you know, a book with a lot of that letter. So for example, if we're doing letter A, first we'll listen to the song that goes with the book, and then we'll sing A says ah, every letter makes a sound, A says ah. And then we'll read the book together. Well, what do you hear if that starts with that sound? So someone might say donkey, and I'd be like, yes, I saw donkey in the book, but donkey, let's think about it, donkey, donkey. Is it the same as ah, ah? And then, you know, then they'll probably say, oh, no, it's not. Okay, let's, and then we'll read it together, and, you know, we'll slowly say, apple. Oh, okay, that starts with an A. And then, like, the second day, they'll circle the A. The third day, they'll write it, and then we'll listen to it again, and then finding it. So that's something that we're doing to prepare them to get the letter, so then when they get these books, you know, they'll be able to do what that child is doing.
That's great. You can see the learning progression right there. And that's what I love about Erla, too, is we go back to where the child enters school, and we pick them up there, and we make sure they're not in third grade with gaps, because we walk them through all of this. You don't go from 1Y to 2Y until you can really do those things, and that's why we scaffold and work with the students so much on it. And so I'm just a huge, I call it Erla Thumper, Erla Thumper, I just love it. Because I have seen the impact in some of our high needs schools that have been just amazing. Thank you for sharing. I'm going to, go ahead.
Regarding the video.
Yes.
I'm going
The one thing that the child kept looking for, and I didn't see him getting a lot of, was acceptance or approval.
She, yes, I can
address
that. I saw a
couple of, only a couple of times, where, and when he did an actual page all by himself, he looked at her to make sure it was right, but she said nothing.
And there was
that acceptable or not acceptable?
Right, there was a little caption at the bottom that said the coach is being quiet to see if the child had strategies or could figure this out. And then it also said that instead of jumping in only when they're wrong or getting, you know, affirmation only when they're right, she wanted the student to be able to, how she said, does that start with that? He'd either say yes or no and figure it out. And so, yes, and that's... I understand exactly where you're coming from. I'm a little more like, myself. I'm a cheerleader out there. And so I actually know Gina, the gal in the video from Pennsylvania area. And that's kind of her personality. And she also knew Ridley. And so that I think might be part of it is with a student she didn't know, I think might be a little different.
Okay, so it would be okay to do that phrase. It would be okay.
I do,
but
I
think for him to know.
But I, yes, and I also do this thing we call duct tape. I'm not saying a word to see if they have any strategies they can pull out of a toolbox. So
but,
I'm going to
sit
on
the
a
page,
moment.
I'm more
right.
towards the pages that he did something right versus where he's doing something wrong.
Mm-hmm. And we couldn't really see her if she was nodding or anything.
Okay.
I do know,
okay,
that part.
Okay, okay.
It could have been a nonverbal.
Okay.
Like that. When he looked at her, she could have been nodding. I don't know. But I do understand what you're saying.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm a little more gushy.
Can I respond to that? Yes. I think you walk the fine line of we want to have kids be reliant on themselves and not to be looking for the adult in their life to constantly tell them they're right or they're wrong, because then if you do that, you create learned helplessness. And so you want to build confidence in the child. So they're used to see. He was looking at her for approval from time to time. So at some point in time, he developed a habit of doing that, and so she's probably working on breaking him of that and trusting his own knowledge about what he does and does not know about language. So it is so hard to put the duct tape on our mouths.
Yeah.
It is so hard because we want to praise, but we need to praise skill and strategies instead of just good job.
Because so maybe just at the end of the book, the praise versus every single picture.
And she, and then praise the strategy.
Right. And then Gina was able to say, oh yeah, woof, water, that matched. So she gave him that affirmation that it was correct, but it wasn't about him, it was about the strategy.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks for asking that. That was a really good question.
Yeah.
The next part is, it's the last part of kindergarten where we get into one green, and we call it 1G, and green is, it's all about sight words, and they call them power words, and I just say, every green book you're going to pick up, I put some out on your tables, has a little green sticker in the corner. Every green book is built on sight words. And the power words are sight words that are taken from our most popular, like our Dolch list, things like that. And they are built on that. Now, here's the one caveat. If it is not a sight word, it is a word they can get by looking at the picture. And so when you look through those, I also gave you the sheet of one green word so you would see what they're expected to know.
You said if they're not? Words,
they're picture clue words. So if it's a desert, the picture is a desert. It's just one-sided. Right. So the one green words are on the green sheet for you. This starts, yes, if it's penguins, it's a picture clue. The rest of the words, they can be
like,
sure
that
we're not eating that.
It's a
attention up here for a moment, please? Thank you.
And if it's
questions?
Well, okay, so social worker. And this is all institutional school we're doing here. Do you have a little version that you can have give parents that they're going to be able to use with the kids at home to direct? That's not as complicated?
Every student has a skills card that goes over what they can take home to work on. It's a homeschool card. And it's a, if you're on in the yellow, it's a yellow skills card. This is what you're working on. And it is for the parents. And if they're in dual language, they have them in Spanish as well. We have dual language classrooms.
Well, more than Spanish,
English. But that's what we have at this point.
Okay.
They're just the Spanish and English. And so we get them from American Reading Company. And so we don't have any other languages at this time. So it's very much so. And then the students are able to take these books home and work on them at home and bring them back, trade them for other books, take them home, bring them back. Now, because I'm just about out of time, I'm going to roll through the green part. Now, we want them to know by the end of kindergarten, about 60 to, I guess, into 75 power words of flash speed. Flash speed, the moment you see a student trying to sound it out, it's not a sight word. And so we don't count those. We teach the students to know them on sight, and we have games and things like that for that. 3 seconds, if it's a student who needs longer time to process, we give them 5 seconds or whatever. It's just that teacher knowing that student. It might be different for different students. Then 2G is when they pick up in first grade, and there are more power words, 2 green. So what I've done is I've copied a little packet for you. I went through an article from American Reading Company on sight word acquisition, and it's talking about the things you can do, little games you can play. I actually played one game this week on the third page. Under the power word flash, I played Dice Run, and we just lay some of the power words out. I have them on cards. And the child rolls a die, they move along. If they know the word, they can put it in front of them. The next student rolls a die, counts along. If they know the power word, they can put it in front of them. And it's saying that having a game like that where they can count how many at the end they have, a you know, friendly competition, not a throwdown, is actually good for retaining that information. And so I read through that article, and these are the things I pulled out of there for you. There are 4 pages here, and I made them on different slides, so you could just kind of go through. It is saying that an average student needs 40 or more successful interactions with each word to learn it. And so I think of students who might be struggling. What does that have on, that impact on them? Or a student learning English? And again, that's where we just read. So this is a take home, the green, or the kindergarten sight words that they know. And then there was the sheet with read to me, yellow, and I got just into the green so you would know what they are working on. I'm not going any deeper into the green because we're talking more pre-K, beginning of K. These are charts I've done with the green that I scaffold all the way back to the 1Y, the students who are just picture reading and trying to pick up a pattern. So every student with a green book, which is about power words and comprehension, they can still picture read if they can't read the words. I can still get comprehension evidence from them using picture clues and having them read the story to me. Then I teach tricky word strategies. I teach this kindergarten through sixth grade. And it's applicable to students all the way through multi-syllabic academic language going on. So it works from picture clues, look at the picture, to say the first letter sound, to even blends and digraphs going on. And going through these. And so one of my schools, every child has this on a little bookmark. We practice it every time I'm there, all the way through sixth grade. So kindergartners can do it,
all the way. So it's really helpful to have little charts that go with what you're teaching. So this is the same thing I just sent with you, so I'm not going to go through that part. And then I had laid some things out earlier, some of the books, and we also have activities for the kids. And we have smaller Erla looking manuals that are yellow and green that I laid out. And those are actual lessons that we use with students in small groups. And we have 6 packs of Erla books. And then we have, could you hold that, please?
Yes.
So we have, this is a 1-3 wide, and it has lessons, and it's like a tent where it sits up. This faces my student or small group. This side faces me with a lesson, and it has the books for the students and activities for them to do. So those go along with it, and we call that the Foundational Skills Toolkit. And so every school has those, all the way up through second grade reading level for those. So that was your basic introduction to Erla. And then if you have questions, if you'd like to stick around, I can definitely answer some. But they gave me till 7:45, so they're going to get the book.
Yes,
definitely. Okay. But I appreciate the sharing and, you know, talking to each other and really getting into that session. That was very appreciated by me. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to just say a couple things, and then I'm going to turn it over to Alice, who is going to do a little closing activity with you to get some information. So I know that this could be a little bit overwhelming, as we are using a little bit of institutional speak or school speak, but what I do know is that you are all doing this with kids, doing these reading things, so we didn't think you weren't. We want you to know what we're doing with kids when they come in kindergarten, so that you can understand and help with that transition for kids coming into kindergarten. And what I want you to know is that Erla is really, it's our second year with it, and it is really a formative assessment. It's not our curriculum. Our curriculum is called Journeys, and we've just adopted it and are implementing it this year. So that's something we'd love to share more with you at another event. But what this is an assessment that's formative that allows us to take the kids where they are and be extremely intentional about scaffolding them in their reading skills so that they are readers. Because what we're trying to do is ensure that every child in the Kent School District is a reader by third grade. And this tool allows all of our teachers to be very intentional about their reading assessment of kids and their instruction and use of strategies. As you can see, the 1Y, the 2Y, and the 3Y, to move through those levels, kids have to master certain skills. And if you haven't mastered the skills and strategies at 1Y, you don't move to the 2Y. So the other thing I want you to think about is you don't need these books to do these things. You can use the books that are in your library, so you don't have to feel like you have to go back and Google American Reading Company and then buy all their materials. You have these books. These are the books that kids read, little books, so you can maybe just go back and organize them differently. Whatever works for you. And then our goal, again, is to have kids be readers. So, and to be very intentional about it. So we hope that we've shared something that gives you greater insight into what we're doing when kids come to us, and that you'll take back something to your program that will be helpful for you. So Alice?
I'm gonna just finish passing out a couple.
Oh, and while she's doing that, then on March 3rd, we're going to invite everybody back in for another event where we're going to bring in our math specialist to do some very intentional work around math instruction, math strategies. Not necessarily we have a curriculum, it's called Math Expressions. We're not expecting you to use our curriculum, buy our curriculum, or teach to our curriculum, but we want to share strategies so that we can have some more alignment between the early learning community and kindergarten. So hopefully we'll see you all back in March. You know you'll get an email from me. So
to conclude our evening, Stephanie shared a lot of information with you, and we know that you also had the opportunity to share with each other.
some strategies and some work that you're doing within your buildings on a day-to-day basis. So we've handed you another bright green piece of paper. You all go home blind with all the brightness that we provided you. But what we're seeking from you is just some feedback about the event tonight. So thinking about some things that you might have learned either from colleagues that are here at your table or around the room when you met a new person or through Stephanie's presentation, some things you want to try. I heard some great ideas being passed around at the tables during the talk. Things that you might be wondering about, some of those questions that either Stephanie's presentation or something else that we might have said that you're wondering about, that you're hoping you might get a little clarification on. And lastly, topics that you are interested in learning about in the future. So as Paige said, we have the March session already in the works in terms of planning, because we wanted to be prepared for sharing with you what you might expect next. But from there, we're really hoping that we can begin to create a community where we're all sharing and providing information to each other. So on the very top, it asks you if there's some particular things that you're interested in presenting, information that you think you would like to share with the group, and we'd love to have that feedback from you, as well as other topics that you're interested in. So maybe you don't want to teach it, but maybe you have some other interests that you're interested in. And if you could put your name and the organization, the school that you're with, that would be fantastic as you head out the door tonight, if you'll leave this with us so that we can take this and make the next event even better.